BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen.
Good evening and welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsmen. I am Kay Bennecoff, your host, and we have a very special treat for you tonight. We are here with Steve Hunter, and he is of the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen, and he is a juried member of Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen, and we are going to throw some stoneware with Steve. Right, Steve?
We are, Kay. We're going to throw some stoneware. I have some lots of clay here, and I have a wheel set up, which I'll refocus for you when we get started, and we'll make some things and answer all your questions. So.
Okay. Well, I'm just going to take a little drink here. Oh. This happens to be a Steve Hunter mug, which I use all the time at the Kutztown Folk Festival and all our shows. So everyone, we're going to see what you're going to put one of these together today, right?
Yeah, we're going to start from scratch. I'm going to start with this ball of clay, and we're going to end up, we're not going to glaze it today, but we'll end up with the form with the handle on it trimmed down, and it'll be ready to dry and put in the kiln. We'll talk about that later, too.
We're going to talk about that later. Yeah, we're going to get... we're going to learn about Steve up close and personal, okay?
Sure.
So let's see. When did all this clay thing happen with you? I think you were just a young lad at that point.
Yeah, well, I always liked working in clay in school when I was in elementary school and stuff. It's kind of fun to make things, and I had success in doing three-dimensional forms and all. And I threw my first pot. I was a Boy Scout, and... I took pottery merit badge because I had most of the stuff completed. And when I got to the counselor's studio, he said, "Well, would you like to throw a pot?" I'm like, "Oh yeah, this is cool." So I guess I was probably maybe 13 or so at that age. And then I also, so that was my first, had a lot of assistants. I still have it around someplace.
Of course you do.
I have everything around someplace, but I believe it's out in the studio. And then I started, I did take a lot of art courses in high school, and my art teacher inspired me to do some wheel work. We had a very awkward treadle wheel that I actually never made a pot on. So, but I worked on it a lot, and, you know, so, and then I asked for a potter's wheel for my graduation present from high school. I went to the University of Edinburgh in Pennsylvania, not in Scotland. And I was an art education major there, and I did a lot of pottery classes and learned to throw there. And I've been throwing ever since. So I've been throwing for 50 years or so, I guess. Yeah. And that's where I was. I live in West Point in Montgomery County. I know it's a little bit far from Berks, but... that's where my studio is, and I have a larger studio there where I have wheels and a couple kilns and clay mixers and, you know, everything I do. I make the clay. I remake the clay. I buy it manufactured once, but I reprocess all the scraps if I have scraps. And I make all my own glazes. They're all food safe glazes, and they're all fired to Stoneware temperatures, which is 2280 is what I fire to. So, and I have two kilns. I have both an electric kiln and I have a gas propane fired kiln. Propane fired one is about 5x5 inside and holds about randomly about 100, 110 pieces. And the electric kiln's basically a quarter of the size. And then last year, I bought some solar panels for the studio. And so when I use the electric kiln, I have a zero carbon footprint, which is pretty exciting for me. So I'll probably stop using the gas kiln at some point. But it does give you some different finishes, because what happens on a gas kiln is that there's less, you can set it for, there's less oxygen in it than it needs to fire from. And so what that does, it pulls the oxygen out of some of the minerals like iron that's in the clay and gives you a richness that you don't get from an electric kiln usually.
Mm-hmm. So, you answered a question I was going to ask you about that, you know, about the difference in firing, you know, with gas versus electric.
Yeah, I mean, I use the same clay body and most of the same glazes, and they look, some of them look very similar, some of them do look different. The clay body definitely looks toastier. You know, if you think of it, it's like the difference of making something in the microwave. It's quite edible, it's functional, it tastes okay. Good. But if you put it in the toaster oven or the oven, it's just toasty, you know. It's a little warmer and a little more friendly. So that's really the difference. And the firings take about 12 to 14 hours to get up to temperature. And there's a slowness curve. You can't, like, just superheat it. You can, but it doesn't work well. So we try to do, like, a 300-degree temperature climb until we get to closer to the top firing, and then we slow it down. And we'll do the different holds, cooling and going up and for different effects. The recipe for clay, which is mostly aluminum, but it's, you know, it's not aluminum like the alumina, like the element. But you'll find that in basically it's weathered granite. You'll add things like feldspar in it to help it melt a little bit, and it will have traces of whatever the mountain was made of in the clay. We also use some ball clay, which is often found under coal mines, like up where you live. Under the coal seam is usually a seam of ball clay, which is a yellow, very sticky clay. And that's very what we call plastic clay. Mm-hmm. So that's good for stretching things like on the wheel. Like if you make things in the wheel, you need your clay to be what we call plastic, so it bends. Mm-hmm. And if we want to make something like bricks, we don't need it to bend at all, because we're just going to press them and they're going to dry. So that's some of the differences. Clay, one's called a long clay, which is a throwing clay, and a short clay is like a brick clay.
Okay.
It has a different thing.
Yeah, may I ask a question? You said that your clay is manufactured one time. I think that's the phrase you used.
Manufactured might be a stretch, but basically what they do is they dig it up, mm-hmm. And they dry it, and then they'll mix it, because think of clay like wheat or barley. There, you have different amounts of wheat or barley or different kinds of wheats to make different doughs. Whether you're making a cookie or a bread, you have different dough. So each mine will give you a slightly different profile of clay, depending on whether it's, you know, a primary clay, which would be like made from weathered limestone in place, like a kaolin, or if it was a sedimentary clay like you'd find up in Hamburg or Upper Schuylkill, where it's all the red, mm-hmm. red clay, mm-hmm. which is shale that's been washed by the water and settles in the river.
Okay, so then that kind of explains why, you know, looking back to our forefathers, you know, back in the 1700s and 1800s when they were doing clay. So if they were from New England, that kind of pottery has that look. And then, you know, further south, like down in Virginia, it may look a little different, you know, like the colors and even the textures of it, right? You know.
Yeah, every mountain has its own signature.
Yeah.
You know? So yeah. It's always a little bit different, has what you might call impurities, but what potters call, like, you know, beauty marks. It has little flecks in it, or it's extra toasty, or, you know, sometimes they have garnets in it that kind of expand when you heat them, you know, or pieces of seashell, which I don't like to work with. But, you know, there's all different impurities in the clay that make it kind of special. But very early on, potters would move clay from even a couple miles away and mix two different clay beds to make the body they're looking for. Like in Chester County is the White Clay Creek. So that's a very early colony in Pennsylvania and Maryland there. So it's a porcelain clay. And so that was used for making pipes and powdering wigs and things like that. So they would mix there's also a red clay creek, which is nearby, and they'd mix those two to get different things. The red clay, because of all the iron in it, melts much at a lower temperature than a stoneware clay, which doesn't have much iron in it. And if you took a red clay and fired it to a stoneware temperature, you would just get a blob of black glass. And you've seen this when you look at historic buildings. When they used to fire red clay bricks, they would stack them in a kiln. There was no structure. There was a way of stacking it. And the firebox would get extra hot. And those clays are called blackheads generally. And they're black. They look burnt and twisted. And most of the clays, the bricks are red. They look nice. And then the real undercooked ones are called salmon bricks. And they're soft and kind of a pinker red. And they're used in different places in historic buildings. And you can see, like in Philadelphia and probably Reading, I'm not familiar with any place, but there are some buildings near me where the blackheads are turned as a decorative element in there. So it looks sort of like a patchwork quilt, or, you know, it's a nice look. Yeah. So that's probably too much to know about clay.
But that's very interesting because, you know, people look at, you know, there's different, when they come to a show or something, you know, there's stoneware, there's redware, there's the porcelain, you know, and I'm even going to throw ceramics in there, right? You know, as right. And well, go ahead.
Well, think of it like there's a million names for beef, but it's all beef, you know, whether it's hamburger or roast beef or Kobe or whatever, there's so many names, but it's beef. So depending on historic times and what it is. It's ceramic, sort of the anything made out of clay. Mm-hmm. Pottery is generally anything that's worked. Mm-hmm. You know, stoneware is a temperature difference. Redware is a lower fire. Redware is always porous. So think of redware like bricks, tile, like roof tiles that you see in old buildings, redware plates, they're all porous. And if you put something on there, especially something like vinegar or something that's thin, it will leach through. So what people in Pennsylvania really liked about stoneware is that it's vitrified. It's completely watertight. So if you're on a farm and you have a lot of corn and you live in Pennsylvania and you live in Upper Schuylkill County, you can't get your corn down the river very easily if you don't live near the canal. So what you would do is you distill it. Uh-huh. So you need to put that liquor into a bottle that is extremely tight. And redware, it will come out. It'll evaporate through the bottle, where stoneware, it won't. So, traditionally stoneware was very utilitarian. It was used in the barn. It wasn't in the house. It was for making cheese or collecting milk or storing molasses or whiskey, things like that, making pickled items, you know, sauerkraut, things like that. That was its general use. I mean, something like sauerkraut, the vinegar does not eat the clay surface, mm-hmm. where traditionally redware was glazed with a lead-based glaze and the vinegar eats through the lead at some point. So then it's not particularly healthy either. So
I was going to say not particularly healthy.
It is if you don't eat any citrus, you know, citrus or acidic things. So
right.
Anyway, so okay. Let me make a couple. Do you have some more questions?
I think you've covered it, Steve. These are the kind of things that people don't find out about. You know, I mean, you know, they come and admire it for its functionality, its beauty and everything, and they know they like it. But they're not always aware of all of those little tidbits that you gave to us. And so it was a good good education, good history education there, Mr. Art Teacher.
Okay, former art teacher. Well, one of the things I like to do is dig clay in small quantities at places, people's farms or property, and found some amazingly great clay bodies. But, you know, they're not commercially, like if you go to Glengarry, they own like thousands of acres of clay land. I assume.
Yes, you know, they do.
But a potter would just maybe have a small place where he can get a couple wagon loads a year. Mm-hmm. And traditionally, especially in Pennsylvania, but all along the Appalachians, potters were seasonal. you would work in the spring after the crops were in, and then probably fire before you would harvest. Nobody worked year round, just didn't do it. So the clay froze, you know, the people froze, and or it was too hot or whatever. So seasonal, and most potters would hire somebody like me to come in and throw a bunch of whiskey jugs or crocks, and then I'd be done. He'd pay me. I'd move the next potter and maybe throw. And they would probably throw themselves. But, you know, it's common to have multiple people. Plus, if you're firing your kiln with wood, which takes a while, takes probably about 36 hours, you need a couple people because you're going to go through like maybe 8 or 12 cords of wood at least. Mm-hmm. So in that 36 hours.
Yeah.
So. All right, we could talk, but let's do something.
Okay, let's do something. Okay.
So all right, I'm going to adjust my screen so you'll just see my hand. So I'm working on a electrified kick wheel. Here's the top of it. Mm-hmm. And so I'm spinning it right now with my foot, and I can make it go either way. And then I also have orange, black cord. I forgot to plug in here. I also have electric cord, orange cord underneath there.
You're not pedaling that?
I'm doing it by my foot now.
This is why you don't have to go to the gym either.
That's good. I mean, there's a little bit of background noise, but what it does, it gives you the motor lets you just work longer. You know, one of the first things that people industrialized were potter's wheels because it was a lot of work. You know, they'd hook it up to the stream, or they hook it up to a Model T transmission, or, you know, whatever they were doing, water power, and have multiple guys throwing. So,
yeah, for sure.
So here's a piece of clay. This is a plaster, we call them bats, basically a plate, and it goes into a receiver here. And so I can just drop these in. And then I have a bucket of water here, which I like to wet this because it'll stick better. And I use, this is a sheep's wool sponge like you would wash your car with or your back or whatever. And this is a piece of an elephant ear sponge. And these are real big. They look like giant ears, hence the name. And people would use these for like makeup sponges or, you know, delicate painting sponges. So, but I use them for delicate work here. So the first thing I have to do is center this.
Called centering.
What's that, Kay?
I said that process you were just demonstrating there is called centering.
I'm going to center this, and then I picked up a piece of dirt in here. I might have to cut it out. Let's see how it goes. Now it's centered, it's not moving. So that's uncentered, and that's centered.
Okay.
Can you hear me through the noise?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. I just was like,
yeah, no, you're coming in. The little tool that you were using, you know, to cut off, what was that? Cutting off the excess? What is that?
It's just a stick.
Oh, okay.
A little scraper. Mm-hmm. A potter's spurtle, whatever.
Okay, spurtle. I like that.
Okay, so I've made the pot, and I'm going to bring it up. Everybody does this a little different. I'm going to make a couple cups first, coffee cups, like you have.
Yes. See, I think this part of it is the magic. I have no idea how you get that accomplished.
Yes, that's true. This is the magic.
Yeah, I look at it, you know, when you're doing it, and I think, how did our forefathers ever come to, come up with this. I just think it's amazing.
Well, apparently this is the third oldest profession, so. So I have the shape of the pot, and what I'm doing here is, on the side of this pot, I've locked my fingers apart like this, and I'm just bringing them up and steering it. And it's a thickness thing. It's not a pressure. I'm not trying to push through. Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to set it. And I usually keep my fingers touching at all times.
Okay.
So I can do that. And, I'll use different, you'll see me use, these are called ribs.
Yes.
I have a bunch of different ones. And initially people probably use rib bones from animals because you have a curve.
Correct.
And so you'll see me shape some of the bigger things. I'm going to make a couple cups and then I'll make a bowl and then I'll make something with a lid. So
okay, because that's how you got those little ridges in, though, just by holding your fingers like
that's
that.
My finger. So now if I was going to, I'm going to smooth these out, I think, and give it a little bit of texture. So let me just do another little bit of finish work on it. So I use pieces of vinyl siding or credit cards to smooth it and to shape it.
Okay.
I just dropped my vinyl siding, but it's okay. I'm bored. So that's done. And then I'll just dump the water out and then I'll set.
Oh, no.
No, the humanity of it. I didn't even see that. I'll make another one. That's pretty funny.
Easily done.
I would tell you that I don't think I've ever had it fallen off in a demonstration before, ever.
Well, see, and now that just shows people that master potters, even that happens to them too. So they should not be afraid to try this if they're so inclined.
Time me, this won't take very long.
Now, does the speed of your wheel have a lot to do with how you're throwing this?
The clay will get waterlogged if you take like 10 or 15 minutes to make a piece, like a novice will.
Oh, okay.
So, and obviously, historically, time is money. So,
right.
You want to throw as carefully as you can in a speedy fashion. Just because you might want to go do something else.
Gotcha.
But I'm not stopping to, chat, so.
Well, right, you're concentrating on throwing as opposed to talking to all of us out here.
Actually, I've been doing it so long, it's actually very relaxing, this part of it.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Okay, so that's done. I don't think this is going to fall off. We'll see. No, didn't fall
off. Yay. Success.
Okay, I'm going to make... to do the same thing because most of the pieces are the centering process is almost always the same and the opening process and all that is similar, so you just have to think what else you could do that's round, mm-hmm. Like people will ask me what I can make and I'll say anything that's a cylinder, anything that's round, and then they'll say some organic shape. I'm like, no, if it's round I can make it. So I'm going to make a pitcher like you would put maple syrup in or gravy.
Like this?
No, smaller, but just like that, but different.
But like this?
Yeah.
Well, let me rephrase this. This is what I would put my maple syrup in because I need a lot on my pancakes.
It's a turkey cream. Yep.
Well, I think your husband should bring you flowers all the time and put them in that vase.
Oh, he should put my flowers in this vase.
Oh, okay.
He does bring me flowers sometimes.
So now this piece is fairly even up and down, and I'm just going to belly it out and give it some style. And just pushing from the inside and holding it back with my finger here.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm doing here, I'm putting in a little bit of a ridge, more of a style thing.
Okay, and you just learn this by, certainly a teacher would help you with that, and just by doing it, right? I mean, there's...
Well, it's probably like learning learning a technique in a sport where someone shows you, and you might go back and get another couple lessons, but it's like... Here's the basics, go practice for a couple of years.
Right, right.
No, I have things that I made 40 years ago, and some of them are, I consider horrible, you know. You know, they're thick and they're not nice, but, you know, as you progress in your craft, your aesthetic gets more refined. So, you know, you're more aware of other things. So this is, again, just like this could be a cup or something else. But I'm going to put a little spout on it. So now it'll be a pitcher.
Okay, and you said, too, then, that you have to work this in a short period of time because it dries out. Is that correct?
Well, no. If I found this with students, a student will work on the same piece for 10 or 15 minutes. And what happens is it gets waterlogged.
Oh, okay. Clay.
So the clay particles are... microscopic flat pieces, you know, like a cube of salt microscopically is a little cube.
Right.
But the clay is flat. So it'll slide like this. Those microscopic plates will slide. So when I stretch it, it slides out. Mm-hmm. So what keeps it sliding is the water in between. So clay's got some weird qualities. And one is that, it expands when it gets wet, and it becomes extremely slippery, as anybody who's got stuck in the mud or fell over knows.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it's also waterproof when it's wet. So they use it to line, you know, garbage dumps and things like that. And that's why we have certain kinds of marshes here, because the glaciers laid down the clay, and then all the organic matter came on top of that. Pennsylvania's loaded with those kind of antediluvial marshes, and they're just cool, so...
Okay.
All right, I'm going to make a lidded piece. And what I normally do, and this sounds probably, I don't know, to me I always thought it sounded funny, but I made the piece first, I made the lid first. Because if you make the piece first, you generally make a bigger piece than you can make a lid for.
Okay, gotcha.
That sounds kind of silly, but... You know, it gets weaker and weaker and weaker as it goes out. And I have two different kind of lids I'll show you later. One's a flat lid like you would see in an antique crock, and the other one's it's actually an upside down bowl. I'm going to make a bowl size now.
Okay.
And
if you're explaining that, though, that makes perfect sense. You would think just the opposite, you know, what you would do. You'd make that, you know, the native kind
of thing. Yeah. So this big piece is what I'm going to make the pot out of. But the first thing I'm going to do is just stick these two pieces together because I'm going to make my lid out of this. Just like all the other pieces, it's round. I'm going to put a hole in it. Now, practice makes better, but I often will stick a needle in and slide my finger down to see how thick the piece is.
Okay.
So it's, you know, it's around a quarter of an inch thick. I can make it thicker or thinner. Caliper here.
Okay. And that's what you use for measurements.
I'm going to measure these and then I'm going to set that aside.
Stephen, do you think that when people started, you know, making pottery way back, you know, and everything, did the wheel come first, or do you think that they just tried to form, you know, form the vessels?
Well, if you look at somebody who's doing a basket weave mm-hmm. with reeds, you know, right. you're turning that form.
Yeah.
And they believe that most cultures or some cultures would line a basket with clay.
Okay.
To keep the rice or whatever was in there. Okay. So, and then they assumed that somebody threw one of the baskets in the fire and somebody goes, oh, look, the clay is still, is hard now. And they made the connection. I mean, who knows? But okay. it's as good a story as any I can come up with.
Right. Well, no.
But I think that normal turning would be what happens first. People would make, you know, coil pots like with snakes or patties. And turn and turn and turn them on their lap. And I think it's pretty, somebody made this quantum leap here, the wheel. But it's supposed to be, I think it's an older use of the wheel than like a cart. You know, like for like transportation.
Okay.
So they've dug these up in Mesopotamia that are, you know, really, really old. So, okay, so I have a bigger piece of clay here. And I'm going to make the pot for that lid. So it's not that there's a lid for every pot, there's a pot for every lid.
Okay, so now we know what came first. So. Kind of like the chicken and the egg.
You know, it's like anything else. Like if you learn how to putt in a golf course, you have to adjust your swing. I mean, that's
right. Right.
I mean, I could stick it, you know, but I could go faster or slower, but this works for me. Everybody throws a little bit different. you know, it's, I enjoy watching other people work on the wheel.
I bet you do. I bet all potters enjoy that.
So this is going to be nothing more than a big cup. You know, it's, this weighs about 3 pounds right now.
Now, once it's fired, then it becomes lighter, correct?
Not really. I mean, I'll trim some of it away and the water will come out. But then you put glaze and stuff back onto it. And
that's right.
It's close. Probably about a third by water weight.
I was just assuming that, you know, with the water, you know, taking water out of it.
Yeah, when this dries, it'll be like chalk, like a piece of chalk. It has no strength or...
Oh, wow.
I didn't have to check my measurement lately. It's too small at this point.
Now you're going
to stretch this out a little bit.
Yep. It's like magic.
It is a lot like magic.
And a science experiment.
It's a lot of physics in here, Kay.
Yes, yes, I see it.
I don't know what any of them are, but they're in here.
But now kids know why they study science in school. Okay, we're showing them the proof of why they need to study this.
Well, I never took chemistry, so I find it now that I, when I work with glazes, I'm like, it's kind of interesting what, you know, all the colorants in the glazes are metal, are oxides, like cobalt and iron and titanium and things like that. So, and they're used in real small amounts, but, you know, you have to... Kind of interesting what they do. Mm-hmm. Not really worried about the top wiggling yet.
Okay.
About a quarter of an inch off. We'll make it stretch it one more time.
Okay, so you are changing the speed, though, of the turn.
Yeah, really, this gets to the point where it's almost ready to fall over. And if I was to cut the edge up top, if I was to cut it, like, vertically,
yeah,
it would fall apart instantly.
Yeah.
It really has no strength. Clay works really good in on compression and really poorly on extension. Okay, that'll be about perfect.
Perfect is good.
Well, I like to say that practice makes better.
There you go. Yes. Yeah, I would think
so that... All this kind of stuff will get recycled.
Okay.
And let me make new clay.
How do you store the clay? I see that you're pulling it out of a plastic bag. Do you
magic bag, yes.
The magic bag, okay.
Yeah, well, I store it in heavy plastic bags.
Oh, okay. And then...
And it's good for a year and a half, usually. It, you know, I try to use it. It sometimes gets a little lumpy, you know, after we work it, and I don't like to do that. Because I'm lazy, so you know, so that's what I do. I just have a bunch of bags here, you know.
Okay. Just store that in your studio there. It doesn't have.
Yeah, to be- each yeah. bag holds about 25 pounds. I usually buy clay in 1,000 pounds or 2,000 pound lots.
Okay.
You know, and which does not take up a whole lot of room. You know,
I mean,
yeah, it's pretty dense. It's pretty heavy.
Okay, let's trim a piece. Let's let me have the mixing bowl first. So what I have here is a mixing bowl that I made, and it's drier. We like to call this leather hard. It feels like wet shoes.
Okay, how long does that take?
It depends.
Well, the weather has a lot to do with it, correct?
Yeah, I mean, if it's rainy, it might take 3 days to dry. If it's, I'm in the basement of the house now, and if the hot water comes on for the heat, it can be dry in 3 or 4 hours. So okay. I like it to go overnight because that works for me. So I just kind of pull on this and popped it off, and the bottom came off. So that's the back. And then what I have here, this is sort of like the end of a drill, where these little feet adjust in and out. And there's other ways to do this, but I like to do this. So I'm also going to go in here and I'm going to feel the curve of the pot. So this was actually used in the pot. So that's sort of the curve.
Okay.
And I'm going to mentally feel this. And I'm just going to, I just put like a thumbnail mark here, just so I can figure out where the curve is. Mm-hmm. I think they'll be clear when I do it. So then I'm just going to hold this up and tighten it up and get some trimming tools. These are two that I use. This is a little mini pear core. If you, maybe your grandmother or somebody had a pear core shaped like a pear, you would scoop the pear center out when you made pear preserves or whatever. Mm-hmm. So this is a little mini one. I do have a big one. I don't have it here. And then this is a wire loop tool. And depending on how dry this is or different tools cut differently. So, and I don't usually put a foot in mine. I usually just round them off and then smooth the bottom. In other words, there's no little ring in there like you have on a plate a lot of times.
Gotcha.
So I'm just trying to make this a pleasant curve and make the pot light.
I like the curly cues.
They're very fun.
Yes, they look.
I always give the kids at the shows, and they drink instantly, obviously. So
I bet they love them. But this is like the design then of your piece then as well, right?
Well, this is still, I'm working with a form. Really like the form has to be. It has to look like the person has to be attractive to look at.
Right.
You know, it's a family show, but you know, so. The pot has to have a nice form. Everything has to go from one transition to the next. And the pieces of the pot are named after body parts. So the top of the pot's a lip or a shoulder.
Here.
And then you have a neck. And you have a belly and a foot. So it's actually pretty good. Now, I usually make a bunch of these at once.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm more in tune with these. This feels pretty good for thickness. I'm feeling the thickness. I'll put that back on.
Well, so each piece, you know, is definitely unique. It's, you can close, but you're never going to replicate it exactly, right?
Yeah. And I don't really do like a pattern that I keep going for years on end.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
Because it's kind of boring to me.
Sure.
A lot of potters like that. I just don't. Mm-hmm. And but I keep the similar form and I keep the color family, but I'm not too concerned that they match. This wire tool cuts a little finer.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't like open up the clay as much.
But I know, Steve, that you do glasses, cups, and you do the wine glasses, you know, where you, so everything is just a little unique in each piece, even though you do, say, you order a set of 8 of them, or your dinnerware, you do that, and everything is just done by hand. So every piece just has a little bit different than the other, but it all looks like it goes together, but it's
still. Yeah, that's true. It does go together.
So this pot's done except for one glaring error. There's no handle on this.
Okay.
I'm going to put on next.
Okay.
Give me that bat back. So this is pretty well balanced and feels pretty good. Mm-hmm. But it needs a handle here. I think I'll put a strap handle on it.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I want. This one's enough. So this is just the same clay body. It's a little harder.
Okay.
You know, it's a little drier. So what I'm going to do, it looks like I'm stretching it, but I'm not. It doesn't stretch. I'm actually squeezing it, and you'll see the. You'll see it get longer, and that'll give you a handle. And I'm going to make a flat, like a almost like a leather piece of belt there that goes on. Okay. So the first couple pulls just don't work. Don't look like I'm doing anything here.
Well, since we're just getting down on a little bit of time here, I'm going to talk a little bit.
Okay.
You are also our show chairperson, okay? You're such a man of many talents.
Yes.
And we have a show coming up, right?
Do we? Oh, yes, we do.
We
have a show at Renninger's.
Yep. May 7th.
May 7th, which is they have a large pavilion that they use outdoors.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I'm having a hard time thinking and doing this at the same time.
Okay, well, that's okay.
So, no, I'm all right. I can do it.
And
so it's on May 7th, and which is a Saturday, and it's 9 to 3. And yep. We have a nice selection of craftsmen from our guild and several other guilds under the pavilion, so it's an all weather venue. You won't get sunburned, you won't get wet, so that's good. There's no admission.
Right.
I'll be there. A lot of other people be there. We have some really nice traditional people, you know, all kinds of traditional crafts and some contemporary crafts too. We have things like rug makers and Froctor people and be a couple other potters. We have woodworkers. We have carvers and turners and what's that?
Weavers.
We have some weavers and lots of other people. So it's certainly worth coming out. And last year was our first one. This is our second one. Last year was really successful. People really enjoyed it. So
it was kind of like our coming out party from the COVID, right?
Yeah. Now, of course, you know, we have a fall show, a holiday show at the field house in Kutztown.
Yeah.
This was real successful this year, too. We had a lot of craftsmen. We had about 80 at the field house, and I think we have about half that amount at the moment for this outdoor one.
Yeah.
But a lot of traditional great people that you'll see in different magazines and different areas and venues, and I think you'll be real pleased. Can't see my head. I think you'll be real pleased when you come out to the show. So also Managers is open, so you can walk through there and get some fresh meat or look at the antiques or something else. So that's a possibility too.
And next month, we're going to bring some of those craftsmen and artists, you know, onto this show, Your Berks Craftsmen. So we're going to highlight some of those people, you know, and keep telling you about how we want you to come out and see us, you know.
Yeah, so, you know, and we have a nice website, RB Crafts. Mm-hmm. And you can check that out. It has all our normal, you know, our information that we use all the time. All the craftsmen are listed.
Yes.
All our shows are listed as rbcrafts.org. And you might also be a craftsman or a budding craftsman and you want to join us. We also support students in our fall show. Mm-hmm. We give generous endowments, I guess. Not endowments. I don't know what you call it. Anyway. So that's all good. So I wanted to show you this pot here I made as a lid. Has the lid. It's one I made yesterday.
Oh, okay.
That should fit right there, and it does. I'm going to trim this.
Okay.
We're going to run out of time, though, right? So, do we need to talk?
No, you can. We can keep going. We have about 7 or 8 minutes here.
Well, let me finish this up.
I just wanted to make sure we got all that in there.
Well, we
got to
get all the paperwork in now. This is just hair tight. So what I'll do is I usually stretch it, but this is a little bit dry. And it's on the same bath that I made it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just taking this wire tool and kind of sweetening up the hole here a little bit so it fits in. It's pretty close.
Okay, so now will that lid go? Okay, I see how it goes in there.
It's right in the groove there. And it's pretty airtight. So now that it's on there, I'm going to give it one more hit. It fit in okay, but I'm going to just open it up a little bit more.
Okay.
I usually try to stretch them with a tool as opposed to trim them, but this one's a little drier than I like to do them. And then I'll just feel this edge. This edge doesn't look aesthetically pleasing to me. So I'm going to just trim this baby down, just like a bowl. I would do the same thing to a cereal bowl.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to put a handle on top and handles on the side.
Very nice. So now, so that we can talk a little bit about your glazes. I see a few of your pieces in the back there, the colors. So you have, that is a blue and gray.
Yeah, this is the blue I've been using for a long time and an off-white. You can hear it has a nice ring to it. That's how you know your pottery is good. If it's cracked, it has a dull thump to it. Mm-hmm. So Stoneware is glazed everywhere except on the bottom because it would stick to the shelf. And you can't prop it up because when this is at its mature temperature in the kiln, you could grab it with tongs and squeeze it like it was made out of rubber.
Really?
It's that flexible. So, of course, when it dries, it'll crack in a million pieces. But this is, you can put anything you want here, flowers, milk, iced tea, mm-hmm. Handle stays on.
Yeah, that's nice.
This is about 2 quarts, so.
Okay, and then you have a green color back there. Oh, green okay. Thing is I'm sure you like
this. This has a flat lid.
Okay.
Which I threw, and then it has the same piece. A lot of times I'll throw like 6 of these, and I'll throw 6 or 8 lids. And then I can make the best fit. Not that I don't measure well, but it just, they're all a little bit off, And again, the same thing, the bottom's not glazed, but it is signed and dated, and mm-hmm. The inside is glazed. So, and this one has 2 little smushed handles, just to make mm-hmm. it easier to move around. Prices on my stuff range from $4.
To whatever.
Not $4. This is a big chip and dip.
Oh, that's cute. Yeah.
So, it gets loaded up with shrimp and cocktail sauce or something.
Isn't that done today? No, I'm kidding.
Yeah. We ate it all. So that's all. That's the glazing experience. And when we mix the glaze, we fire the pots twice. So the first time, but not all potters do that, but that's what I do. The first time they come out very porous, just like a red flower pot.
Okay.
And then the glaze is mixed up and it looks sort of like thin pancake syrup or melted ice cream, that consistency. But it goes in, I dip it in for maybe a 10-second count, and then I might do other things to it. And then I wipe the bottom and it dries, goes back into the kiln. The second kiln's fired at a much higher temperature. So the second kiln's higher to the Stoneware temperature. The first kiln is only fired to about 1700 degrees.
Which is
literally red hot. So
I was going to say only 1700 degrees.
Yeah. So I guess that's the deal there. Any other questions? We're going to run out of time here, I think, in a minute. I'll have to come back. Maybe next month you'll have me back.
Well, I will have you back next. Well, we have a few minutes here. We will have you back next month.
And what are we going to do next month? We're going to have some visiting artists.
Next month, we're going to be bringing some of the craftsmen and artists who will be at our show in May. Okay. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and I guess we'll either be in the studio. Maybe we'll have a combination of being in the beautiful new BCTV studio down at 401 Penn Street in Reading, and or maybe some will be coming in through Zoom so that we can, you know, show the people a different, you know, a lot of, because our craftsmen come from all over. I mean, they're just
not, our guild is pretty huge, actually.
Yeah, we outreach, yes, you know.
Yeah. Well, I'll be there in person, right? You want me in person?
Yes. Oh, of course I want you there in person.
In the BC studio, which is fun. And last year we had I guess 3 or 4 people in there, me and 3 others and all. And
it
worked really well. So it's a good show to watch, and it gives a good taste of what's going to come up from at our show, other people you could see. You know, we had a carver and a guy that did heavy metal sculpting. You know, he was welding and laser cutting stuff, fascinating stuff. And
yeah, well, that was before the holiday show. Last year before our first annual, you know, first Saturday show out at Renninger's there, we did that all through Zoom. Remember, you know, we were in that COVID part yet, you know, and stuff.
Yeah, so that's true.
Like I said, I was kidding. I said, but that was like our, you know, coming out party, you know, last year.
Yeah. Well, it was a new studio and a new show, so it worked good.
Absolutely. So we keep evolving, we keep getting more members, and we're always looking for more people who are interested in crafts, and we like to share our knowledge, you know, of our crafts, and just like you did today, Steve, you gave
such and, you know, also, we have people that are not craftsmen that are members of the guild, because they like to be around craftsmen, and they like to be the crafts. We have, every month we have events. I mean, we have a you know, entertainment or something. This month, we're going to have a lot of technical stuff about doing, setting up your web pages and proper advertising techniques. And so it's more of a business oriented and really a must go to meeting for our members. So,
but people are invited. They can come to.
Oh, yeah, you can come to the meetings over at the Goggle Works. Easy to find, great parking. So,
first Tuesday of the month,
you know,
we're at the Goggle Works. So, Steve, I can't thank you enough for letting us come into your studio today. Okay, it was great fun. And tell Lisa thank you too there.
I will. You'll see her at the show also. She's a Froctor artist, so she'll be there. And thanks for the doing the show, Kay. It was a good time and seemed to work out really well.
Yeah, it did.
I'm going to use another half an hour, but maybe people would have tuned out at that point. So who knows?
Yeah, we always want to leave them wanting more.
Yeah, well, there'll be more. So
we'll let Barry say hi, and then we're going to go, okay? So
all right.
There's my husband, Barry. Okay, we'll see
you. He's the president of the guild.
Yeah, he is the president of the Reading-Berks Guild. And so
I hope we did a good enough job to let us keep doing this. So
I think so. Okay, so thank you to everyone out there, and we'll see you next time.
We'll see him in May. We want to see him at our show.
Absolutely. Okay, take care now.
Thank you.
Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading-Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.